John Ringen, and I was born in Everett, Washington, 1928. I had an uncle that came over from Norway, and he became an artist because physically he couldn't do much else. And he made a living, good living. And he was a writer, and he did other things too. But he was an artist, and he worked full time as an artist. And so he was my inspiration. I found that I wasn't interested in much else. Well, I didn't know I was that interested in art either, but I knew that I was mentally lazy. And I was pretty close to the bottom of my class. Oh, there's a couple other guys that were maybe lazier than I, but there weren't many. And so I took up art. And then I got into a little art program that I was they're looking for somebody that was incapable of paying attention. And so I would be sent to the art room. I loved it there. I was all by myself. I could do anything I wanted to. And the teacher would look in periodically. She was an art teacher. And the thing that was interesting is that I became a teacher. And when I taught the first year at Marysville High School, and I was a counselor, I guess I was some kind of a specialist. And so I was doing one of these specialist things at the Everett Community College, and my art teacher from Garfield grade school, and she showed up, and I didn't recognize her. She said, "I still have something you did." I found that to become an artist, I had to also jump through the other hoops, like make up math class that I had skipped. Well, I got tossed out of it, actually. But I had to do everything else to get through high school. And then, of course, in college, I still had to do other things. I wasn't just an outstanding artist. I struggled with it for a lot of years. Well, I was a fairly good athlete, and I got a scholarship to Washington State the first year. Then I found that I wasn't quite as good an athlete as I thought I was, so I went to the Everett Community College for a year to think it over. My coach told me that'd be a good idea. That'd be a good place for you to go permanently. And so that the next thing I did, I went to the University of Puget Sound. It was College of Puget Sound in those days. And played a little football and ran track. Well, I held the state record in the low hurdles at the community college low hurdle record. And I held the University of Puget Sound long jump record. And I graduated the University of Washington. I went there, and I used up my eligibility. So I had to go to work. I also made a mistake, got married. wasn't my wife then. We've been married 48 years. But yeah, it's, I had to go to work. And so I went, enrolled in school, and my grades were good, surprisingly. And they were good from right after Washington State. I got one in art and a BA in education and an MFA in painting from the U. So I got the trifecta. I became a teacher. I went to school, graduated, got a teaching certificate or whatever they give out, and went to work the first year at Marysville. And even though I liked it, I left because I really wanted to get a master's. I had graduated from the U, and then I applied for a master's. You have to have a pre-candidacy show before you qualify, and then you have that. Then we went in, I guess, well, I was accepted. There weren't that many. I think there were six of us that were in the candidates that qualified for painting. It was a pretty good program, except you had to be an abstract expressionist if you expected to do something. And I wasn't an abstract expressionist, but I kind of warped my way into that position, yeah. You're given 3 years to complete it. If you don't complete it in 3 years, you're welcome to apply again, but it's not encouraged. So after my third year, I says, because I've worked during the summer every year that I taught, and I was teaching in Seattle then, and that's how I kind of forced me in a position where I had to produce, and luckily I charmed the faculty. I got my degrees and I went to work, and I taught school for 30 years. Uh-huh. And then I taught for the U too. I don't know how long, but it's quite a while I was there. There was kind of a special program that seemed to fit my temperament. Because they would ship me out to go up to, I taught in Alaska, Canada, Eastern Washington, pretty much all over the state. Bellingham, up at the college up there, at the Western. I moved around a lot for about 6-7 years, yeah. And met a lot of people, so I became friends. So it was it was a wonderful program. What I did also, I worked for 8 years at Walter Dorwin Teague as an illustrator. And I moved into that as an abstract expressionist to become an illustrator.
Well,
I seemed to learn to do it. but I had to work, really work at it. And one of the things I found that the day I showed up for work, I put my head down and went to work. And the other guys had been there a long time, and they could accomplish as much as I did by not working quite so hard. And so, you'd think I'd be pretty good, that I have spent more time teaching than I have practicing. And if you go to my studio, you won't believe that, because it's a mess. And paintings all over the place. There are a lot of bad paintings. You go through a lot of bad paintings. Once in a while, a jewel drops out. Unfortunately, I would sell the jewel because it'd be the only one that would sell. Recently, I saw one of the jewels. It was bad. Yeah. So I thought, you know, that's a good thing. I've improved. So there we are. I have. If you go through the house, you'll find a lot of paintings. If you look, really look in all the spots, you won't be impressed. You know, when we started, when I joined the Watercolor Society, I think I was 20 years old, and just going to the U, and we used to have meetings, and we'd have a little talk of critique of the watercolor. We'd bring the paintings there and critique them, and we'd sit around on the floor, because the places that we met were houses, and we'd sit with, maybe there'd be 10, 15, 20 people at the most, and a couple of bottles of wine. And those that preferred to drink wine or root beer or whatever it was, and that's pretty much what the Watercolor Society was. And it had been going on for quite a few years. The one mission that we had was the show at the Seattle Art Museum. They had the annual watercolor show at the Seattle Art Museum, and it was a good show. It was a good show at that time, and we had people, artists that were competing from the U and from other, well, we had guys like Toby and so forth were involved in it early on. And so they had, it was a class show. And if you made the show, and I usually made it for some dumb reason, partly because they were showing a variety of stuff, and there wasn't anything like mine, I guess. I was pretty clumsy. But yeah, that was it. Now it is a big national show. I made the watercolor show, I think, for about 4 or 5 years straight, and people got to know me, and they thought I was a good guy, and I should become a member of the Puget Sound Group of Northwest Painters. And so I became a member, and I became a president of it. Eventually, you got to serve your time. It was fun. Now, it's not fun for everybody. It made a drunk out of me, it was well worth the effort. I liked Hickson, Bill Hickson. I'm sure he's probably gone, but he was a young teacher, strong painter. I thought he was God, and he might have been. He registered with me. I think he was probably one of the most popular teachers. And he also, I liked the way he worked. And so it wasn't experimental, it was pretty direct. He got his master's at the University of Oregon. That's what you want to do. You're really convinced that's what you want to do. Yeah, it's a good life. And you get some people that kind of admire you. You get some people that are jealous. You get some people that know that you're a fraud. So, you get all kinds of, it's a lot easier to work in the supermarket than it is to be an artist. And, but to be a teacher, it's twice the problem, because you're selling yourself. And I find that teaching in the public schools, not every kid loves you. Matter of fact, most of them don't like you, but they put up with you. But there are a few. And I've seen some successes. I've never made a success out of a kid. I'm a watercolor painter, but I sneak in acrylics. I painted in oils. I keep saying I'm going to go back to oils. I have oils. Watercolors are comfortable. I can move around without ending up with them all over my clothes. I work fast, and I think that has a lot to do with, I invest an hour or so in a painting and I put it aside and I start another one. Not many people can say that, and you don't have to worry about the drying because it dries. I can take it home and I can look at it again, and I can either screw it up or I can possibly get one of those gems. Doesn't happen very often, but sometimes it does. Also, the framing of a sheet of watercolor. Take another look at what you do. If you can find a little spot in the painting that frames well, looks good, sell it. Because that's your statement. I can tell you, I've never reached a point where I could earn a good living as an artist. Now, that's a struggle, and that's a fact. And I wouldn't want to have to survive on just doing that. I don't have the courage to give, you know, a retirement. You know, I got the teacher's retirement, I got Vicky's retirement, and I got her father's retirement. We got lots of retirements going on in the Ringen household. So, I've never made a living at art. God, it's good not to have to. It really is. And I admire those that do. And it's, I know it hasn't been easy. It isn't easy. You know, there's so many artists that are pretty good, but they can't make a living. You have to have a personality. I, first of all, don't have a personality. I'm not driven. I'd rather go to work at something else, a warehouser. I worked there for quite a few years, all through high school. And I'd rather do that, pull lumber on the grain chain, than have to make a living as an artist. Because I knew I would get a check at the end of the month. And I can say that I don't need to sell. But it is an acknowledgement that maybe I've done something that's worth looking at. But the greatest gift of all is not being able to do anything else well. And that followed me all through school.